In the early days of aviation, as the field of aircraft design was just beginning to take shape, engineers were constantly experimenting with new airframe concepts. Aerodynamic layouts ranged from groundbreaking innovations to outright oddities. Many were quickly tested, and while some faded into obscurity, others laid the groundwork for future advancements. Among these was the twin boom design, which offered several advantages: streamlined engine placement, efficient landing gear configuration with a nose wheel for easier takeoffs and landings, and the ability to mount heavy armaments without gun synchronizers. The design also allowed gunners in the central nacelle a wide range of fire coverage. Most twin-boom aircraft were produced during World War II. Most commonly, this layout was used for designing heavy multi-role fighters, such as the Fokker G1A or the SM-91, as well as reconnaissance planes and even seaplanes, like the German BV-138. The most famous example of a twin-boom aircraft with effective tail gunner placement was the Focke Wulf FW-189, a German reconnaissance plane. Pilots of the Allied forces frequently noted how difficult it was to intercept this aircraft due to the highly advantageous placement of its rear machine guns, which covered nearly the entire rear hemisphere. On the Eastern Front, the FW-189 earned the nickname Rama, or the Frame, for its distinctive square silhouette. Its ease of handling and excellent flight characteristics allowed crews to linger over enemy positions for extended periods of time and maintain stability in the air even when operating on a single engine. The most mass-produced twin-boom aircraft in history, however, was the P-38 Lightning. Developed by the American company Lockheed, it was manufactured throughout World War II, with more than 10,000 units produced, a record unlikely to be surpassed by any future twin-boom design. The efficient arrangement of components ensured excellent balance, while the relatively long tail moment arm provided good maneuverability for an aircraft of its weight. During the war, Lightnings served as reconnaissance planes, ground attack aircraft, and night fighters. The top U.S. Air Force aces flew P-38s, as did the famous pilot and author Antoine de Saint-Exupéry. Notably, P-38s played a key role in the audacious Operation Vengeance, which targeted and eliminated Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, the commander-in-chief of the Japanese Navy. Northrop engineers sought to replicate Lockheed's success. In 1942, they developed the world's first specialized night fighter, the P-61 Black Widow, which was the size and weight of a medium bomber. Its appearance resembled the Lightning, but its production run was far more modest, just over 700 units. Unofficially, the P-61 is known as the plane that ended the war. In August 1945, after Japan officially surrendered, a P-61B named Lady in the Dark shot down a Ki-44 interceptor, whose pilot may not have been aware of the ceasefire. Even neutral Sweden embraced the twin-boom design during the war. In 1943, Saab introduced the J-21, a fighter equipped with one of the first production ejection seats. Its rear-mounted pusher propeller made conventional bailout impossible, so this innovation was a necessity. The J-21 debuted in the war's final year. But instead of fading into obscurity, it was modernized in 1947 with de Havilland Goblin turbojet engines, purchased from Britain, creating the upgraded J-21R, which also entered series production. The British company de Havilland was among the last to use the twin-boom design for production jet combat aircraft. Their famous lineup, including the Vampire, Venom, and Sea Vixen, with their distinctive appearance, became a hallmark of British post-war aviation and saw widespread export success. Despite its advantages, the twin-boom layout never replaced the classic single-fuselage design. One key challenge was building compact yet strong tail booms, which often ended up being structurally inefficient. For instance, on many American models, the booms housed little more than control rods for the rudders. With the advent of the jet age, the large cross-sectional areas of twin-boom designs hindered their ability to reach higher speeds, making them less competitive with streamlined single-fuselage aircraft. Still, much like biplanes, twin-boom aircraft remain a fascinating chapter in aviation history, far from being forgotten.